Welcome back, everybody, to the last leg of Vedic Wisdom Festival 2021. We are in the last quarter of the Vedic Wisdom 2021 and hopefully the best quarter of 2021 Vedic Wisdom Festival. Before I get to the next speaker, a few clarifications once again. A lot of y'all have asked about classes. Where do Swamiji and Swamini conduct classes? You'd like to join. I'm reminding you that all details of classes are available at vedicwisdom.in or discoveratma.com. You can go to either of those sites and find out where these classes are running and details and log on and get in touch with Swamini and Swamiji and enroll if you're interested. We are also seeking your permission and informing you that we will be sending you a monthly newsletter called Arshya Vidya Bharati, which has got lots of articles related to Vedanta and related topics. Every month we send it out. Now that we have your email ID, we'll be sending it out to you. Please do have a read. There are some people who have asked about, is there something for children? A couple of questions yesterday and today about asking us whether there is anything for children. Well, we run a program called SHINE, Spiritual Heritage of India for Next Generation Empowerment. This program has classes and camps for children from the age group of 6 to 11 and has many educational videos on the YouTube channel. If you need to know more, you need to log on to discoveratma.com. But there is a program for children which gives them a window to this wonderful world and our culture and our heritage. And if you're interested, please get your children to log on and watch these videos and attend these camps and classes. Now, moving on to our next subject. I don't know if all of you all remember, but yesterday we had Dr. Parthasarathy, the Ayurvedic doctor who spoke to us about Ayurveda and mental health. And I don't know how many of you all caught the fact that he said that it was Sanskrit that actually led him to this huge world of the medical stream of Ayurveda. His initial passion was Sanskrit. He learned Sanskrit, and through Sanskrit, he realized there was this very, very vast medical stream, which he then adopted and became the Ayurvedic doctor that he is. So Sanskrit has got, and if you speak to Swamini and Swamiji, they will always tell you that beyond a point, when you get into after Bhagavad Gita, Vedas, Upanishads, it's always preferable to have a knowledge of Sanskrit, to have a better understanding of Vedanta and the Vedas. It always helps. Most of all, Sanskrit is the mother of all languages. We have today our next speaker, Professor Anantrama Iyer. Professor Iyer is an erudite academician who has done his MA in Sanskrit, philosophy, and astrology, and an MPhil in Sanskrit with a diploma in Hindi. I struggled to do my BSc, but you know, fantastic how people study and gear themselves up for such a fabulous future. He has held prestigious positions like Head of Department of Sanskrit, Head of Department of Indian Philosophy, and was former Dean of Vivekananda College in Madurai. He has published 5 books and presented papers at national and international seminars in Sanskrit and astrology. So I just asked him this passion for Sanskrit, where did it come from? And he said that it ran in the family. His grandfather was a Sanskrit Pandit, and therefore there was an influence of Sanskrit in the whole family. And therefore he was exposed to Sanskrit at a very early age. And he took to Sanskrit therefore early. He loved the language. He loved the way it sounded and what it stood for, and therefore mastered the language. And what's best about him is that he's from my neck of the woods. He's from Palakkad. Welcome, Professor Anantrama Iyer, on the greatness of Sanskrit, a bird's eye view.
Namaste, namaste, namaste. Shall I start?
Yes, sir.
Please. With your permission. Thank you. Udhyat bhanu sahasra kodi sadrisham keyura harajjwalam भीमभोष्टीं स्मितदन्तपङ्क्तिरुचिरां पीताम्बरालङ्कृतां विष्णुब्रह्मसुरेन्द्रसेवितपदां तत्त्वस्वरूपां शिवां मीनाक्षीं प्रणतोऽस्मि सन्ततमहं कारुण्यवहरां। My humble salutations to Goddess Meenakshi, the mother of this city, Madurai, by whose grace I am standing before you, by whose grace I am now still in this position, by whose grace I am today living. Revered Swamijis, who are all the great masters in the particular ashram, Swamini Brahma Pratyananda, who gave me an opportunity to speak in this forum, and Swami Adhyatmanandaji Maharaj, who is the Kulapati of our institution, where I am working as a head of the Department of Indian Philosophy, and who is the Kulapati there in our institution, Vivekananda College, Madurai, and who is one of the faculty members who teaches philosophy for students there. And great scholars, my good friends Vikram and Sureshji, who have introduced me, and all the great learners, people with having the same mind and a cultured mind. At the outset, let me thank the ashram or the association or organization giving me an opportunity to speak about the glory or the greatness of the Sanskrit. Now, let me start with the topic. I am going to give very brief idea. I told you in advance that when I talked to Sureshji, he said, what is the area that you are going to present? I told him, today you have given a topic like an elephant and I have to put it in a small bottle. I will try my level best to put into that one. And at the same time, I will make it to understand. It won't be more technical. It will be very, very simple. It can be understood by everybody. I have taken to this way. Right. Now, let me start with that. Today, I am going for language part of it. I am not going for any literary part of it. Because language is a one which is meant for communication. Language, without language, one cannot exist in the society. It is the one which is expressing the ideas. It is the one which makes you to understand the people across you, which is the one which makes a diversified society under one banner. Like that, language has got lot of advantages. Now coming to Sanskrita, Sanskritam is also a language. And how far it has got its greatness, how far it has got its glory, that we are going to say today. It is also a tool for communication. Why this tool has come out? Because India belongs to a category where we have got lot of people who have got great knowledge. Rishis, sannyasins, great scholars were there. If you go back, all those things, you can very well understand it is a repository of knowledge. That much people were there. And these knowledges have come there in their mind. What was the tool they have applied to express it outside so that it will be having a benefit to the society? So they took this language as a tool to express their ideas, to widen their thoughts, what do you mean by Rishi? Rishi is a person who can tell you as a researcher, who make and work, because we have got three things are there. What is the matter? How is the matter? And why is the matter? The third aspect is the one which leads one to the research. Now, this research aspect has been made many rishis to write so many works, whether it is in philosophy or as Dr. Parthasarathy about mentioning in introduction, about Parthasarathy, he said that Sanskrit is the language through which I studied Ayurveda. So that language was the one which was helping to study Ayurveda. If anybody is there who want to go for an accountancy or auditing in Arthashastra of Chanakya, they have to go for a basic knowledge of Sanskrit. If anybody want to know something about the archery or architecture or astrology or mathematics, whatever it be, all these fields are completely filled up with so many works of ancient Indian contribution. But the tool to understand them is only the language Sanskrit. So it is a basic necessity for a person who want to understand, then interpret, to make apply to his own field of knowledge. He requires a knowledge of Sanskrit, because anything studied in that particular language alone will be understood properly. For example, if you are cooking anything in your kitchen, then if you taste it, you will understand it tastes properly. Whereas if you are watching in a what is called YouTube business, how to cook all these things, you cannot taste it. You will be seeing it and coming back. Like that, any translation studied for which field you have to make your knowledge more, you should understand that language and should try to study as much as possible in that same language itself. Of anybody who is interested in making his attempt to study the works or the great repository of Indian tradition, they should know Sanskrit. This is the basic need of studying Sanskrit or understanding Sanskrit. Then next question comes, what is the purpose of these Greek people to choose this particular language as the carrier or a tool to express their ideas or to interrogate with others who has got the same of the things? How they had the vada prativada, so many things they were putting it in the same tool, because they found that this tool is something perfect which will not lose its what is called shape or charm or structure at any cost. That is why, because if you are purchasing certain things, for example, an AC or a car, whatever it may be, you will try to choose one which is the best one, which will be useful for a long time. Likewise, people are the great scholars, rishis of ancient time. They took this language as a tool to express these things, because they found out this is a suitable language for them. You know very well, you are reading Ramayana, you are reading Mahabharata, you are reading what you call Bhagavad Gita, you are reading a lot of Upanishads. These are all written years and years and years before. But still, a person with a basic knowledge of Sanskrit can easily understand Gita slokas. How? Because the structure which has been framed early, about 2000 years before, has not been at any time, it is not at all been interpolated. It was not disturbed. It was not given any sort of damage in any place. So the language which has been framed about 2000 years before with its framework has been till this day, it is carried on and will be carried on in future also. So that type of structure is given for this language. That is why it is called as Samskritam. Samskritam means Samyak Kritam, which is done to the perfection core. So when it reaches, for example, if there is a liquid, if you put some salt or sugar, it has got a saturation point. Like that, Sanskrit language, when it has been framed or it has been structured, it has come to that saturated point. Nothing can disturb. It is like a black box which cannot be destroyed or dismantled at any time in a flight, or whenever even the flight gets get in accident or it gets into some trouble. Like that, it is a Pandora box, it is a black box, that full grammar. What is a grammar? Grammar is nothing but which deals with the structure of a language. A language has got two things basically. One is called Shabda, another is called Artha. Mahakavi Kalidasa says in his Raghuvamsa, first sloka, Vagartha viva sampratthau, Vagartha pratipattaye, Jagatah pitarau vande, Parvati parameshwarau. I bow to the universal father and mother, Parvati and Parameshwara, Lord, who are like Vak and Artha, who are combined each other with the sound and the meaning. Where sound has to exist with a meaning should have a sound. Vagartha Pratya, they are interdependent. They are symbiotic to each other. It cannot exist without that one. It lives on this one. So, Vagartha Pratipattaye, the first sloka of Kalidasa gives a beautiful idea about a language. Like that, Sanskrita is the language which deals with two things. One is called phonetics, Shabda. Next is called semantics, the Artha. Now, the question comes, who made this tool? Who framed these rules? Who is the person behind it? By whose person, contribution the language has been carried on till this day? Not only till this day, it will be carried on forever without any sort of distortion. If you take English, the Shakespearean works cannot be easily understood by a person who studied a normal English language now, because they call this Gothic English. If you go to any other language, modern language, Tamil you take, if a person who studied Tamil and he cannot understand a Thirukkural or ancient Sangam literature without the help of a Vyakhyana or a commentary. Whereas we understand Bhagavad Gita easily. We understand slogans of Ramayana easily. We understand so many texts of Kalidasa or Bhavabhuti or Vararuchi, whatever movie. All these slogans are understood easily because the language structure which has been framed very, very in the old days has been carried on till this day. Nobody can dismantle it. Who is the person? Who is the one who has done this wonderful work? Is none other than the great grammarian called Panini. Panini, he was living about 5000 BC. All these discussions, I am not going for that because time is very short for me. Panini is the person who has made all these formations. It was very difficult for you to understand Panini because he has made all these scientific applications for a language in the form of sutra. Sutra means, you know, it is a thread. If you have got a basket of flowers, it is very difficult to carry the basket of flowers one place to another without having spilling any of these flowers. Whereas, if you take a thread and if you make this flower attached to that one like a garland, small garland, the basket of flower will be completely condensed in the small garland of 1 or 2 feet, 2 feet or 3 feet, which will be easy for us to make a bundle and put it in the pocket and go. Like that, Panini has also made his rules and regulations for the grammar in the form of sutra. He call it as aphorism, shortest form, which are pregnant with meanings. And his work is called Ashtadhyayi. Ashtadhyayi is none other than which contains 8 adhyayas or 8 chapters. How did he do? I told you in advance. A language should have two things. One is called Shabda. Another is called Artha. These two things are not existing. It is not at all a language at all. Apashabda, Apartha. You have got ha, hu, here the sound is there. It cannot be taken as a Shabda. A Shabda which has got a proper Artha alone be called as a Shabda. a artha or a meaning which has got a proper sound or a word alone be called as a meaning. So they are interrelated. So Panini has made his attempt, not I won't say attempt, he made it perfect way. He started. Any language will have in the beginning. We are all people who have studied from kindergarten to this day. When we go to the school, first thing is when we study language, we go for alphabets. And even these alphabets are arranged punctually, perfectly, with a scientific reason by Panini. Very, very perfectly he has arranged. These sutras are called Maheshwara Sutras. You would have heard of it in so many places. Like that, what is called 14 sutras are there. These are all the 14 sutras which gives an idea about how many consonants are there, how many, what do you call, vowels are there. So there are 16 vowels in Sanskrit language and 36 consonants are there. These are all beautifully arranged by Panini. And why they have made it sutra? Because it is easy for us to remember. Small lines are very easy to remember. That is why they have made it on sutra. Now, Panini has made his attempt to give in such a way that his words, his sutras are all having pregnant with meaning. For example, if you want to use these letters again and again, he had prepared his own zip files, which is already existing in computer nowadays. Then he comes gradually to the language part of it, or the letters, shabda and artha part of it. A language should have, or a sentence, letters come together to form the word. Words form a sentence. Sentences forms a paragraph, and it will give an idea, essay like that. That's the basis. So as if the brick is a basis for a building, like that, a letter is the basis for the whole, what is called language. So these languages, these letters are taken into two sections. It has been made as the, what is called combination, as if you find in English. Because vowels, we have got not only A, I, I, O, U, like that. We have got A, E, like that, vowels are there. Ta, ka, ga, ga, na, cha, cha, ja, ja, na, we have got consonants are there. If you pronounce A, B, C, don't be saying I have degraded English. I'm just for a comparative sake, I'm telling you. A, B, C, D, like that. You don't have any proper, if you put it in a sonometer, you cannot find any proper wave. But when you say ka, ka, ga, ga, na, cha, cha, ja, ja, na, like that, he has given sutras in Panini sutras. Ahuka visarjaniyanam kantaha, ichuyasanam talu, rudurashanam murta, rudurashanam dantaha, upupadbhanam oshtaha. These are all the five vargas. Ka, cha, ta, ta, pa. They have classified according to the sthana or the place from where the sound arises. For example, ka, ka, ga, ga. Everything arises from the gutter or guttural portion, neck. So they have called is kandaha, they called. Ichu esanam talu. Talu means the palatal region. So if you say e, cha, cha, sha, when you pronounce all these letters, naturally the tongue will go and touch your palate. So it is called palatal. Ritu rashanam murdha. When you say r, ta, ta, da, da, all these things, when you pronounce it, the tongue will twist back, it will shift back, it will have a vibration in your forehead. Murdha. Ritu rashanam danta. If you want to say r, ta, ta, da, da, you should use your dental region, teeth, then only you can pronounce all these things. You call it as danta. Upupadbhanam ushtaha. U, o, pa, pa, bha. These are all the pronunciation by which, for which you have used the lips, labial. Very, very simple. He has given five words called khanda, thalu, murdha, then what do you call danta, then oshta. Last one, nyamagananam nasika. If you do nya, ma, na, 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 we have to use the nasal. Very good classification, which you cannot find anywhere, any language I can challenge. So like that he has classified. Now he have come for what? Words. Today I am going to speak about the language part of it. I am not going for Mahabharata or Kalidasa or Kathopanishad or anything of the sort. This is the basis which contributed for the greatness of our Indian literature. That is why it has been made as a tool for expressing the ideas of the great persons. So now he has divided these are the formation of letters. These letters became in combination, they will have words. There should be a consonant and a what you call vowel. That combination gives words. These words are again divided into two by Panini. Very simple, as you find in English or Tamil or Marathi or Gujarati or any language as you like. One is called noun, another is called verb, which is called Subandha and Tikanta. Noun, we have got a classification, bigger classification. There, nouns has been divided into three genders. Generally, in other languages, genders are divided according to the material or the object which gives the meaning. Whereas in Sanskritam, it is not like that. It is how it is pronounced. By the ending of the pronunciation, you can decide the gender. For example, he, she, it. These are all the three genders pronouns that we have in English. Whereas he will be representing all the male formations and other things. She will be representing all the female formations and other things. It will represent all the neutral gender. Whereas in Sanskritam, you have got like that. This is called Shiraha. Pronunciation as what? Aha. It is in male. It is a what is called Pullinga. This is Nasika. This is a Srilinga. This is a Nayanam, which is a Nabumsalinga. So this is Aha. This is A. And this is Am. So even in our body, very dear to that, we have got three genders. How and why? Next question. Why? Because Panini is not aware of the fact, we don't say that Panini is not aware of the fact that you are representing this, what's called in different genders of the same face. But still, he has got its rules and regulations that the endings alone will be indicating the gender. Number one. And each gender or each word will have what is called case endings or karakas. These karakas will be helping us to construct the sentence in a proper way using different cases. I'm not going for the details of it, just I'm telling you. So there we have got 7 vibhaktis and 3 what is called numbers, ekavachana, dvivachana and bahuvachana. So each word will have 21 forms. For example, if you take Ramaha Shabda, Ramaha, Ramu, Ramaha, like that. Like that we have got Rame, Ramayoho, Rameshu, Saptami, the 7th will be there. So out of the words you form, everything will have 21 forms. That about the Subandha. Now we are coming to the verbal form. Verbal form, verb, you know, there should be minimum 2 things in a sentence. One is called a subject, another is called a predicate. There should be a noun, there should be a verb. There should be a karta, there should be a kriya. These are all 3 things. So there, the karta is classified according to the verb into 3 things. first person, second person, and third person. Uttama Purusha, Madhyama Purusha, and Prathama Purusha. And there also we have got three classifications. Ekavachana, Dvivachana, Bahuvachana. The wonder is that each verbal form, for example, Gacchati, go. Padati, to read. Very simple sentence, very simple verb sentence. This pada is a root which has got 90 forms of Tidhatu Rupa, which is a wonderful thing, how it has been made. In any language you analyze in all over the world, you cannot find this much of scientifically formed 90 forms. It is called as what is called lakaras. You would have those who have studied Sanskrit, you would have seen lat, lit, lut, lai, lot, like that, lung, ling, lung, all those things. 10 lakaras are there. And these 10 lakaras give different meanings. You will be wondering if I say there are 3 past tense in Sanskrit language. You are reading what you call Bhagavad Gita. There you have got Bhagavan Uvacha, Arjuna Uvacha. What do you mean by Uvacha? Uvacha is none other than Avadat. Vadati Uvacha. Vadati Avadati Uvacha means he spoke. But it is a lit form. Why it has been used Uvacha? Why in the nearest of one you are using Avadati? So these are all certain things. The time is the factor which decides these 3 past tenses. Like that, we have got 2 future tense. Like that, you have got 3 commands. So all together, we have got 10 forms. Why Panini has made so strict? Because nobody should tamper the language in future. What are the ways anybody can prick inside and mute it is what it's called. It should they make a distraction. Nobody can do it. As if I told you in advance, it's like a black box of a flight. Nobody can do it. So 90 forms, wonderful. And what is called each and every word of noun will have 21 forms. Wonderful. Nobody can have it. Because there the peculiarity in the Sanskrit language is that Dvivachana. Nowadays many people have started avoiding it to have more accessibility to the language, because they find it, because they are not used often. So many are avoiding it. Ramaha, Ramaha, Ramam, Ramani, Rame, Ramai. Like that, they started studying. But actually, if you go to Paninian grammatical way of studying, that should be the way that one. So 90 forms. And there, yeah, we don't have any prepositions. As if you find in English, in, on, by, with, like that. These are all postposition, as if that you find in Hindi, kose, kose, kame, ramko, ramse, ramko, ramse, ramka, ramme. These are all the 6 endings that we have. But in Sanskrit, it is agglutinated. It is formed as a form of the word itself. Rama is there, means Rama, Ramam, Ramena, Ramaya, Ramatu, Ramasya, Rame, like that. The Rama root will be there, the form will be there. So many other suffixes will be added by which will be done. Why I am taking this pain to make you to understand all these things is that this language has got its own beauty. This language has got its own perfection. This language is the one which will not mislead you anywhere in the meaning. It will give a perfect meaning. Each and every word has got its own independency. For example, I am telling you a word. Rama killed Ravana. If that is the case, means if you just put in a, what is called, you put both words in a altered way. For example, Rama killed Ravana. Ravana killed Rama. The meaning will change totally. Whereas in Sanskrit, if the sentence is Ramaha Ravanam Hananti. So the Ravanam is represented by what is called Dvitiya, the second case, that will be always give independent meaning of the Karmani or Karma. Likewise, they have, Kapadini has very, very, very strict in making that each and every word should have an independence in expressing the meaning. That is the greatest contribution by Panini, because that has helped many poets in the future to make what is called descriptions, very, very great descriptions. You know, there is a work called Amarakosha. This is called a thesaurus of Sanskrit language, which gives lot of synonyms for different words. For example, there is a small anecdote is there. The anecdote says that is believed to this sloka has been constructed by, been written by Kalidasa. It is attributed to Kalidasa. I will tell you the content. I will give you the last line. Lord Shiva, along with his family, is sitting in Kailasa. There was Ganapati is there, Lord Goddess Parvati is there, and Shanmuka is there. And Shanmuka was asking his father, "My father, you are doing it in such a way, you are troubling my mother. You are having Ganges on your head." This is the sloka which is taken from Bhoja Prabandha of Ballada Sena, where he describes the meeting between Kalidasa and King Bhoja. That is why we have attributing it. Right. And he says, "Oh, my father, why can't you get rid of this Ganges, which is troubling us a lot, which is always flowing water and making the whole place dirty?" Then Shiva says, "Oh, my son, what can I do? Where can I place it?" Then Shanmuka says, "Ambhodir jalanidhi payodhir udadihi varanadi varadi." You can pour it into the sea, ocean. There, Shanmuka uses six words for ocean. Very easy. Ambhodhi, jaladhi, payodhi, udadhi, varanidhi, varidhi. How? That is how the Sanskrit language's beauty lies. What are the words that you find for water, if you add dhi, will become ocean. Amba, water, dhi, umba, a treasure house, jala, dhi, payaha, water, udada, udaga, water, vari, water. So if you add dhi, I'm giving all these five letters, just five words, to just keep it in mind. If you add ja, ajayate, ambadu jayate, abjaha, varijaha, payojaha, udajaha, varijaha. If you take these words, when you add jayate, or which is born out of water, you get the meaning of lotus. Now, if you add dadati, means to give. If you add da into all these things, it will give the meaning of megha. Imagine how the language lies. By just understanding only 5 to 6 words about water, you are creating your own words about the words which are related to water. One is a treasure house of water, the samudra. Now the lotus, which is born from the pond or water. Now the clouds, which are having the, which are pouring from the sky. So like that, if you take anything, now you know very well, there is Vishnu Sahasranama is there, Lalita Sahasranama is there, so many Sahasranamas are there. There's nothing but, these are all Paryayapadas, synonyms of lords. These are all formed only because of this technique of Amarakosha or Paninian grammar. What I want to stress here is that this is the language which has become very suitable for machine translation also to this modern days. There is a pakka portion called Karaka Prakarana. This is not, I'm not going for the detail. I am not making you afraid of technical terms. It is a Karaka Prakarana. Karaka Prakarana means which induces to work. Catalyst, you call it in chemistry. we have got 7 vibhaktis or 7 cases. These cases are applied in on but kose kose kame in English also, but Padini interprets in different way. Different way means now he defines each one vibhakti. For example, saptami is there. Saptami is indicated by in or on. Then he says adharo adhikaranam. You call it as adhikarana karaka. What do you mean by adhikarana? Adharaha. Substratum, which indicates a substratum, is called the adhikarana. Adhikarane saptami. When is in what is called a substratum, a base is indicated, naturally you have to go for seventh case. It can be easily applied for all languages. Almost karaka or the case endings are all uniform all over the world in all languages. So suppose if you put this as a mediate language with this karaka prakarana into effect, naturally any language can be put in one side and it can be translated easily to the rules and regulations prescribed for the that language, whether it's a prefix or suffix, it can be brought out. This is how the Panini has contributed. That is why it has been useful for this present day, what do you call, computer languages, natural language process, and all these things are, there's a lot, big field, or a vast field, which I am not going to detail. Now, we will come for the next aspect. Next aspect means few, it's called sites about the Vedas, as well as the classical language. Now, Panini is the person who is in the center, who joins both the Vedic period and the classical period. Vedic period, you know, which is the period where during which the Vedas are formed. You know, we have got 4 Vedas, Rigveda, Sama, Atharvana Veda. Each Veda is divided into Samhita, Brahmana, Aranyaka, and Upanishad. And each and these are all the what's called general structure. So 4 into 4, 16. What do you mean by a Veda? I told you in advance, there are certain mantras which are chanted generally in the temple. That is a myth going on all over the world, not only all over, especially in India. Oh, some people are chanting in the what is called temple. That is their duty, they are chanting. But they have not understood that is the one which makes you to understand what is life, how you have to live. These two things are understood in Vedas. Veda means with you to know. Veda is the one which is guiding you how to live. Vivekananda says, Vedas make a man a better man. Then a question arises. Wow, we are not living as men, is it not? Yes, we are not living as men. Because there are two things, two aspects of a Vedas. If you put all the Vedic injunctions, Vedic rules into a big one, a grinder, and if you condense into two things, two small capsules, it will say two things only. One is called Satyam Vada, another is called Dharmam Chara. Satyam Vada and Dharmam Chara are the two basic principles of a human being, which we are not at all following at any cost. That is why we are given instruction through Vedas. E Satyam Vada means we are doing actually to say, according to Panini, we say Da is has got non-aspirated sound. If you go for aspirated, for example, if I say Satyam Vada means to kill Satya, which is going on over days. Dharmam Chara, you follow the path of righteousness. If you just stress on Chara means to just remove the duties from the society. So it immediately changes the meaning. That much the perfection is there in Panini. So if these two things are followed, everybody in this world, all living beings, not only us, all things in the world, our universe, except one person, is none other than you and me. We are the people who are not following the rules and regulations which are ascribed to you. So that should be understood through Vedas. Vedas are nothing but making you make a man a better man, to understand what has been given there. So in Vedas, we have got four portions. These four portions, that society is there. Society should have people. Then only you cannot have society. A single coconut tree cannot become a big grove or mango grove or coconut grove. It should have people together. There, a minimum four type of people should be there. One is a teaching class, a class with brilliance or education to guide the society in a proper way. Number two is a protecting class, which is the one who should take care of the protection of the society. And third is merchandise.
Professor, you have last 2-3 minutes.
I will stop it here, sir.
No,
sorry.
You got last 3 minutes.
15 minutes more, huh? Thank you.
Last.
For 4:20, I will close it. Sorry, sir.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you. Please. I will complete this one. Merchant class. Then you have got what is called working class. So we have got four classes in the society. Each and every individual has got four stages in life: Brahmacharya, Grihastha, Vanaprastha, and Sannyasa. So Vedas are nothing but the rules and regulations for each group of the society and individually in each stage of his life. So in Toto, it says that dharmam chara, follow the dharma. So it is not meant for any, it is only not meant for Kerala or Tamil Nadu or Maharashtra, or not only for India, for the whole world, universe, even for each and every human being who is living on this world. So it is not confined to Hinduism. That is why we call it as Satadana Dharma, which has changed into Sanatana Dharma. Sada, always existing one. The Dharma is always existing. These are all certain principles which is existing, which is not meant only for a particular religious people or particular section of people. It is for human being. It is for the human being. So that is the way in which Veda should be understood. If it is seen in this light, naturally people will understand what are the things that they can, what is called, rectify, what are the mistakes they are doing it. They can lead a comfortable life, and they will be leading to the knowledge. They will be going in a spiritual path or in a right path. That will be the help or the great contribution through the Vedas one can receive. Like the Upanishads are there, one is called Karmakanda, and this is Jnanakanda. I am not going for the detail because of the lack of time. And this is, I have told you, the language has got this much perfection. If in future, if time permits for me to speak to you, then I'll go for the next section, how far the classical aspect of the language has contributed a lot in kindling you, in understanding you, or encouraging you in your life, by which we can lead a perfect life. With these few words, let me thank the organizers who have given me an opportunity to justly share some of my thoughts regarding the glory of Sanskrit. Namaste, namaste, namaste. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Professor Anantram Iyer. That was very, very lucid. It was very clear. I don't think there's any doubt about what, there's no question, there's no doubt about what you said about the way you have explained Panini's intent of making Sanskrit a universal language, and the way you have described it, it is truly a universal language and truly a language without a single flaw. It doesn't have a single flaw anywhere, and as they say, you can't improve perfection. So therefore, it is a language that cannot be improved. So thank you so much, Professor Anantram Iyer. Unfortunately, we are running out of time. So
sorry,
we don't have, so what we will do, no problem. So what we will do is, if we have some questions, Professor Iyer, specific to Sanskrit, we might send them to you. Please do answer it and send it. If any of the viewers have any questions, we might mail it to you. Please answer those questions and send them back.
Thank you. Thank you.
Swamiji, would you like, Swami Brahmavidananda, the founder of Arsha Vidya Foundation.
Namaste, Swami.
Namaste, it was beautiful.
Thank you, Swamiji. Swagyu. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
This lot of people are encouraged to study Sanskrit seriously. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. My pranams to you, Swamiji. My pranams to you.
Swamini, would you like to thank Professor Anantaram Iyer?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Namaste, Swamini. Because of you, I got an opportunity.
And I also see, you know, the love for Sanskrit is so much that we wanted to talk more about the different shlokas across, you know, Kalidasa and all of that.
Yes, sure.
We hope that there will be another opportunity.
Okay, whenever you give me an opportunity, I will try my level best to explain certain things which are found to be. Okay.
Namaste.
Thank you, Swamiji.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
I will log out, sir. Thank you very much.